Karen Rosenberg is one of my oldest and dearest friends in the field of anthropology. She is professor and chair of anthropology at the University of Delaware in Newark, Delaware, and her research specialty is the evolution of the hominin pelvis. The pelvis as a structure reflects a trade-off between walking and standing upright and the need to give birth to large-headed babies. And Karen's work has focused on that trade-off in early hominins, at the origin of the genus Homo, and in my favorite group of early hominins, the Neanderthals.
When we look at human evolution, the evolution of the pelvis is one of the central features. And it seems to me like when we look at what happened, you know, when we became bipedal, there's a radical shift in the musculature of the pelvis. And then when we become Homo, we're still bipeds, so one might think that, you know, everything happened. What's your favorite story about how the pelvis evolved?
Well, I think what's really interesting is that people for a long time have known that the pelvis was completely modified when we adopted a bipedal form of locomotion. Mm-hmm. But what people, and then people always assumed that changes related to birth came later when brains got to be bigger. Uh-huh. But what I think for a long time people didn't sort of say explicitly was that the locomotor changes caused us to have to give birth in a different way, right? So the pelvis itself changed because of the way we were walking, but that change in our walking had obstetric consequences. And so we had to evolve a different way to get the baby out, this completely modified pelvis. And so even in our small-brained ancestors, Australopithecines, they were giving birth a different way than any living apes.
So in apes, what is the birth process like?
In apes, the birth canal of the pelvis is long from front to back and narrow from side to side. And the baby is very small compared to the size of the birth canal. Mm-hmm. So the baby passes through very easily. It doesn't really matter exactly the way it passes through in terms of orientation of the head. There's a lot of room to spare. It looks to us, when we watch videotapes of chimpanzees giving birth, it looks like it's pretty easy compared to the way it is for us. But for humans, the shape of the birth canal is completely modified so that it's now flattened from front to back. And in Australopithecines, the pelvis was flattened from front to back at the inlet, the beginning of the birth canal, at the midplane, and at the outlet, the bottom of the birth canal. And so the head could not pass through if it was oriented from front to back.
Right.
The head could only pass through facing from side to side. And that was sort of the primitive condition for Australopithecines. Later changes caused the evolution of some expansion in the size of the birth canal as we got large brains.
So when you make the transition from an Australopithecus pelvis to a Homo pelvis, increasing body size, obviously, but other kinds of anatomical things going on, is that like a key moment in our evolution?
What's interesting, actually, about Australopithecines is that the pelvis was incredibly broad. Mm-hmm. And I think that kind of hasn't gotten enough attention. There's a very famous picture that Owen Lovejoy published in a Scientific American paper where he has a modern human female pelvis and an Australopithecine pelvis, and they're the same breadth. Although the Australopithecine is like 3 to 3.5 feet tall, and it's an average modern human who's over 5 feet tall.
Yeah, yeah.
So that means that relatively, Lucy's pelvis was very, very wide. And we keep that condition, but as brains started to increase, as newborn baby brains started to increase in particular, you couldn't get that much increase in brain size within the constraints of a very broad, flat pelvis. So at some point, probably after 1.5 million years ago, I would say, some expansion took place in the front to back dimension, and we get this much deeper pelvis in humans, and that allowed the head to turn as it passed through, and that allowed the birth of large brains. So I actually think that it may be that we couldn't have evolved large brains until we were able to have that rotational mechanism of birth.
Okay. What do you think is the connection between birth and sociality or you know, social groups? Or I think, you know, when we think of birth today, I think a lot of people, if they've not had children, and a lot of people who did have children in the old days, do not think about, you know, what's actually going on when kids are being born.
Well, the thing that's really distinctive and unique about humans and the way we give birth is that we give birth in a social context, mm-hmm. right? When women, females are ready to have their babies, they look for people to help them, right? Sisters, husbands, midwives, obstetricians, anyone who can come and help. And that's a very sharp contrast to the way other animals do it. When other animals give birth, they actually seek solitude. They try to isolate themselves from the rest of the group, mm-hmm. to try to avoid attracting attention from predators or from other members of their group who might be too interested in the birth process. And so they give birth in isolation. The reason that humans give birth in a social context is because the complicated way we give birth actually means that there's a benefit to having someone there to help out. Mm-hmm. So that birth assistance is actually, there's a selective premium on it. And so so human birth really evolved in that social context. And I think that has a lot of implications for the way that we form relationships among, especially among females, and that we help each other out in this difficult and sometimes very scary time.
So this seems to me like an area of our evolution where, you know, a lot of people today, they're thinking about, okay, what is the sensible way to approach the birth process, or what's the sensible way to approach pregnancy? You know, and they think, well, we've got an evolutionary history. What does evolution tell us about this? Do you think there's any message that evolution is telling us?
Definitely. Definitely. I think there's some very concrete things that we learn. For example, the way that human women usually give birth in the United States is that doctors like us to lie flat on our back with our feet up in stirrups. And it turns out that that's a very unusual posture if you look cross-culturally. Mm-hmm. And usually women are in some kind of vertical position or squatting. And squatting has been demonstrated to actually increase the size of the outlet of the birth canal, mm-hmm. And give you some extra millimeters, which is sometimes all you need to have a successful outcome. So that's one very practical thing. But the other thing is just to realize that the experience that women have when they're going into labor of wanting to be surrounded by people who care about them and people who are going to give them moral support makes a lot of sense in terms of our evolutionary history. Mm-hmm. And so there's now a big movement to have doulas in the delivery room. Doulas are people who are there just to support the mother. They're not involved in the delivery of the baby. They're just there to provide emotional support. And it turns out that women who have doulas present have lower rates of C-section, lower rates of intervention of various kinds, and shorter labors. Mm-hmm. And I think that speaks to the idea that these social needs that we have during this really important time in our life history is very real and very important.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about Neanderthals, because you really got your start studying the Neanderthal pelvis. And it's, Neanderthals are so close to us in many ways, and yet there are these anatomical differences that are sometimes quite consistent. And the pelvis is one of these areas. Mm-hmm. What do you think is going on with that?
I'll say that some of the differences between Neanderthals and modern humans and the pelvis are related to the fact that they were very big, robust people, mm-hmm. who were not very tall. Mm-hmm. So if you compare them, and that's what I did in my dissertation, right? I compared them to modern human groups who had similar sorts of body proportions. And groups like some Arctic populations who are fairly short but very stocky and robust, mm-hmm. were in the direction of Neanderthals. So I think that in some ways you can think of them as sort of just outside the modern human range of variation, but a kind of logical extension of the patterns that we see in modern humans. There may be some small differences in the shape of the pubic ramus that we probably still haven't explained.
Yeah.
And that I honestly don't understand. I've spent a lot of time thinking about it, and I don't understand it, and I'd welcome your suggestions.
Maybe the students will have suggestions.
Maybe they would. Please, write to me.
How did you get started? How did you get into anthropology?
So, looking back at my childhood, I realized I was always kind of interested in anthropology, but I certainly never as a child said, I want to be an anthropologist. I went to college, I was a history major, and my roommate was really interested in anthropology, and she was taking a lot of anthropology classes, so I took some. And then I switched my major to anthropology. But I was at a university where not only did they not have a four-field approach, where they would expect us to take courses in all the subdisciplines of anthropology. They didn't even suggest it as a possibility. So I just studied cultural anthropology and a tiny bit of archaeology. And then when I graduated, I knew that I was excited about anthropology, but I really had no idea what I wanted to do. So I volunteered on an archaeological project in Spain, and I went and excavated a Mousterian site in Spain. And then I came back to the States, and I had a job, a poorly paid job, as a research assistant for a herpetologist who was interested in the functional anatomy of tadpole mouths. And he kind of took me under his wing, and he said, I have a project for you. You're going to do this scanning electron microscope study of this surface of the tadpole mouth that secrete mucus that help in filter feeding. You didn't expect this, did you? And so I did that study, and it was very evolutionary and ecological in orientation. That was my first publication. And then I started thinking, like, well, I'm really interested in the cultural anthropology, and I love the archaeology, and then the evolutionary biology. And I thought, well, what's the intersection of that? And it turned out I realized that was biological anthropology. So I applied to graduate school. I had never taken a class in physical anthropology, but I got in and I went, and that's what I ended up doing.
Yeah, I think we find a lot of people, you know, just they stumble across it in a lot of ways. If you were giving advice to somebody who wanted to get started and say, you know, I really love this area, you know, regardless of, you know, their age or whatever, you know, what would you do?
I would say get a really good broad education. Mm-hmm. Try to learn to write well, try to learn to think critically, try to pick up some technical skills in some area that might come in handy later. And don't be sort of discouraged by what people tell you about what's going to happen with the job market. If you really like doing it, you should pursue it. And if it doesn't, if you don't end up being a biological anthropologist at a university like John and me, you will find something that you can end up doing, and it will serve you well no matter what you end up doing.
Okay, awesome. Well, thank you so much for doing this, and I've really enjoyed it, and I hope everyone else has too.
Thank you.